Thank you everyone for being here today. Good afternoon. Our early days in life, in many ways, they set the tone for the quality of life later on. And even though we have known this for years now, what if I told you today that the health of our baby's guts, and specifically the microbes that live within their guts, can help us predict their future health? See, this idea of microbes promoting health is quite new. And the reason is that for the past 150 years, and up until about only 10 years ago, microbiologists like myself have been mainly focused on the bad reputation of microbes. They cause disease, they cause pandemics and death. The only good microbe is a dead one, goes the motto. Yet brand new cutting-edge sciences is teaching us this other side of the coin and is giving us information that calls for a change in attitude in the way we raise children. Each one of us has, at all times, a huge number of microbes living in and on you since the moment that you were born. Recently, this large community of microbes was given a name, our microbiome. They live on every inch of your body that is in contact with the outside world, with your gut being the place that they prefer the most. You have this many bacteria in your intestines at all times. That's a one followed by 13 zeros. That's a lot. See, for every single cell in your body, there's at least another bacterial cell just in your gut. And for every gene in your cells, there's 10 to 15 bacterial genes in and with you at all times. And this, we didn't know about that much about this until very, very recently. And bacteria, they're not just this large number. They're a lot more than just this huge number. They are this powerhouse of active metabolism that is in direct contact with your body. And contrary to popular belief, having this huge number of bacteria with you does not cause you harm. In fact, it's quite the opposite. It keeps you alive and it keeps you healthy. And again, we didn't know that much about this until very recently. And how did we figure that out? Well, through research, but not just any research. We started working on this using germ-free mice. Germ-free mice are animals that are born and raised in sterile conditions in laboratories. They're completely devoid of microbes. And using these mice and comparing them with regular mice that harbor microbes in them, we found three essential ways that microbes keep us healthy. The first one, microbes alter our energy metabolism. If you take a germ-free mouse and if you put bacteria on it again, this germ-free mouse is going to experience a gain in weight of about 60% without eating more. Bacteria, we know, they break down food for us, and they also allow us to extract more energy from it. They also produce compounds that help dictate how you store and burn energy. We also know that they're key components of our immune system. Bacteria allow our immune system to mature and develop. Germ-free mice have very sloppy immune systems. They cannot control disease very well. Bacteria do that for us from the moment that we're born. And last, and this was really surprising when we found this out, they also alter certain aspects of our behavior. Bacteria, germ-free mice, we know, they respond differently and poorly to disturbances in stress and memory. Bacteria, we know now, they help us manage primal behavioral responses such as stress and fear. So again, we didn't know about this until about 5 to 10 years ago. In scientific terms, this is what we call an aha moment. And this is one of the newest, but at the same time, least understood frontiers of modern medicine. Yet the next aha moment came when we realized that the most important time to look after our microbiome is early on in life. See, when you give an antibiotic to a baby mouse, this mouse is going to experience a stronger and more permanent hit in the microbiome than if the same antibiotic is given to an adult mouse. But what's more, the change in microbiome experienced by the baby mice made them more susceptible to develop asthma later in life, something that did not happen to the adult mice. We wanted to see whether this happened in children as well. So we followed the microbiome of hundreds of Canadian babies until they started preschool. And what we found was pretty amazing. We found that three-month-old babies that are missing only four bacteria, types of bacteria in their guts, were a lot more likely to develop asthma by the time they started preschool. There seems to be this early critical window during which changes in our gut microbiome makes us more susceptible to asthma, a disease of the lungs. Yet other laboratories around the world are showing that there's also an early critical window for obesity, allergies, and inflammatory bowel disease as well. And why is it that there is this early critical window? See, when we're born, we go from zero to billions and trillions of microbes really, really rapidly. Babies are literally bathed in vaginal and fecal secretions the minute that they're born into the world. And this is a really good thing, because in those secretions, there's these type of microbes that are the ones that kickstart those physiological processes that I was talking to you about. Another factor that is key in shaping this microbiome is breast milk. Breast milk, we now know, is not sterile, but it's actually, it has microbes. And this part was fascinating to me. It not only has microbes, but it also has the right nutrients to feed these microbes. In fact, these nutrients are not digestible by the baby, only by the microbes. When a woman is breastfeeding his or her child, she is not only feeding her baby, but also his and her microbes. So as the baby grows, this microbiome continues to fluctuate and change up until about 3 years of age, when it becomes stable, strong almost as a unit. But before this time, it's a lot less resilient and more susceptible to changes and alterations. And alterations to our early life microbiome does come with consequences. If you see this graph, you'll see that the incidence of many immune and metabolic disorders has been on a skyrocketing rise for the past two generations. Diabetes, obesity, asthma, allergies, inflammatory bowel disease, autoimmune disease, even autism. And this has happened at the exact same time that society has seen a steady decrease in very dangerous infectious diseases. Through a very effective campaign of hygiene and antibiotics, a true triumph for modern medicine. Yet research is showing that this is not just a mere coincidence or an association. As we clean up our world to prevent diseases, we also make our immune systems and our metabolism more susceptible to develop them later on. And this is important, because we now live in an era of antimicrobial everything. The word antimicrobial is in fact used as a sell pitch for things that go from laundry detergent to fabric. Never before in the history of human life have babies grown so cleanly as they do today. There's hand sanitizers in every other diaper bag, and they get wiped cleaned at the first peck of dirt. Our diets, which affect our microbes directly, have never been so poor and so fiberless. We are really, really crappy hosts to our microbiomes, especially early in life. Yet, with this new knowledge comes the real challenge and question, what do we do about it? Because as parents, and I'm one myself, and as a caregiver, you need to balance out the fact that you need to prevent really dangerous diseases, which is still of paramount importance today, and also you need to promote this healthy exposure to microbes. How do you do that? Here are the takeaways for today. The first one, birth vaginally and breastfeed if possible. But we know that this is not possible all the time, and at the same time, the woman's autonomy to decide how she gives birth and how she feeds her children is extremely important as well. We also know that we can benefit the microbiome beyond birth and breastfeeding, which brings me to number two. Whenever you feed your baby, think about feeding your baby and his or her microbes. And microbes thrive on fiber, and we live in a fiber-depleted society. Think about whole grains, vegetables, and fruit in every single meal. Yeah, even breakfast, every single meal. And think also about supplementing with fermented foods such as kefir and yogurt and sauerkraut and pickled vegetables and all of those things. Number three, make smart and somewhat dirty decisions every day. A really good example for this is hand washing. Hand washing is without a doubt one of the best public measures to prevent disease, and we should continue to do those. But it's only effective, and it's mainly effective, if we do it at certain times. After we use the washroom, before we make food, before we're about to eat, if we have been with someone that has been sick or is sick, or if for whatever reason we have been in contact with animal waste. But other than that, we should let kids be kids and get dirty and promote it, actually, because dirt does not equal disease. Number four, antibiotics. This is a big one, because antibiotics are wonder drugs. They have saved millions, and hopefully they will continue to save many millions more. But antibiotics aren't a targeted missile that is only going to kill the bacteria that you're having an infection with. They're a carpet bomb, and they will kill that bacteria and many more. And there's no other factor that has been more strongly associated with the development of the diseases that I talked about than the use of antibiotics in the first year of life or during the late stages of pregnancy. So what do we do here? We need to be more restrictive about antibiotics. If you require one, there's no way around it. You need to use one. But they're being overused and overprescribed. So talk to your doctor to understand really when an antibiotic is necessary before the age of three. And last but not least, vaccination. And I know this is controversial, but hear me out here. Vaccination, as opposed to an antibiotic, is a targeted approach. When you become vaccinated, you lose the chance of getting infected with one microbe and one microbe only. And it doesn't affect the whole community of microbes, as we know through experiments. Vaccination is the only reason why we do not get really horrible diseases that we used to get. And if we got one of them, that would also increase our chances of having to use antibiotics, the carpet bombs. At the end of the day, going back to that balance, we know that promoting healthy exposure to microbes drives health. But exposing ourselves or our children to a dangerous microbe does the exact opposite. So we still do not know that whole story about the microbiome. I think we will hear a lot more of this fascinating field in the next decade or two. But what we have in front of us is undeniable evidence that microbes are extremely important to our survival and our health, especially early in life. I have given you some information today, but I really urge you to get even more. Nourish this powerhouse that you have in your guts with your children. Bring up your children and their microbes. Thank you.